This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Well, today on Dreamland, we are going to be talking to somebody just like me who has a beard and a few other things that are different. But one thing we have in common, we both are close encounter witnesses, big time. And you'll see later, Paul has had some injuries to his body that are very similar to some that I've had. And we will show the images on the show later, side by side. This is real, folks. It's not real. And it's not theoretical. It's not spiritual. Or it is spiritual. But believe me, not always. And sometimes not in a good way, and sometimes in a good way. Paul Vidal, welcome to the show. I'm so glad to have you with us.
Thank you, Whitley. It's really, really exciting to be here. It's honestly, it's an honor.
Well, thanks. It's an honor. Excuse me, folks. Just a second. My chair collapses. Probably all kinds of horrible things will happen during the show because I hope not. I don't want any electronic glitches. Powers that be, glitch us not today. Thank you. Well, thank you. It's an honor to have you here, too. And it's also wonderful that an experiencer is sitting here face to face with his name on the on the screen with you folks, because we are going to be more and more taking our own lives in hand. We've been beat up enough. It's time to accept us. Accept us. And I'm speaking in particular to the scientific and academic communities and the government. Now, I can understand the government being a little iffy about this because, after all, this went on for years, a threat from above that was taking our eggs and semen. And the Air Force not only didn't do anything about it, but somebody, the Air Force or the CIA or whoever, I don't know who, went on a campaign to discredit us. Right now, the FBI is out there quietly trying to interview close encounter witnesses and saying they're going to investigate the abductions. Come on. Their only purpose is to produce a report that the big media will eat up, the New York Times, the CNN, Fox, all, maybe not Fox, but most of them will just eat up. And that report's going to say the FBI investigated these abductions and they never happened. That's the point, folks. So if you get contacted, if some people already have, with a nice note, we want to help you, they don't want to help you at all. They want to continue the pain. That's their only job. Their job is, and this has been a long time coming, but it's true now, their job is to protect the government, not the people. Okay. When it comes to this, I mean, they've got other things they do that are good. I won't say it's all bad. But when it comes to this, oh, no, forget it. Oh, Paul, okay, let's go. Well, I want you to tell us a little bit about your background. You look at me, a guy my age, you look about 14. How old are you, actually?
I'm 33 years old. I'm born and raised in New Jersey. I've been interested in this topic for as long as I can remember, certainly as long as I've been able to read. I essentially learned to read through taking out books on UFOs or Bigfoot or the paranormal, you know, back when I was in grade school. And it was only later in life that I truly came around to the subject, but yeah, it's been a lifelong process for me.
Now, it's interesting that it's been all this. Is there any, when did you really start? You learned to read on it. You must have been like six, really young. So was this something in your early life, do you think? Have you had any indication of that?
Yes, I have had an indication of that, and I wonder more and more as time passes whether I might have had a lot more contact that I'm unaware of from my childhood years. But yes, I did start reading around that age. At the time, it just seemed like an inexplicable interest of mine. You know, I used to watch Unsolved Mysteries religiously, sightings, etc. I used to take out those Time Life books from my school library.
Well, but those were good. I remember those fondly.
Yeah, fantastic and great for children with all of the illustrations and things like that. So I was inexplicably or not inexplicably drawn to the subject. As far as I remember, I just have one paranormal incident from my childhood, and it was this encounter with what some people have come to call the Hat Man, essentially a shadowy figure, tall, with a trench coat or a cloak or something to that effect, and always described with this wide-brimmed hat, almost like a bowler cap or something like that. I don't know if that's the word, but not quite a fedora, but a wide-brimmed hat. And there are thousands and thousands of people that have encountered this entity. I was not aware of that until fairly recently, even though that this encounter occurred when I was about 5 or 6 years old. But yeah, later in life, I did some reading and discovered that this is a very widespread phenomenon. And in fact, I opened up to my father about this only to discover that he and my uncle had an almost identical encounter with this same exact entity back in the mid to late 60s when they were living at my grandparents' house, sleeping in a bunk bed. So yeah, that was my earliest encounter with anything strange.
Okay. So it goes back a bit then. And tell us about the actual this figure.
Sure. Well, all I can say for sure is, as I remember, the incident was that I woke up in my bedroom at my old house where I grew up in northern New Jersey. And this figure was standing in my doorway, extremely tall. Like I said, it seemed to be almost reaching the top of the door frame. It was just standing there, kind of looking at me, menacing me. I didn't notice any facial features, nothing like that, but it seemed like kind of a three-dimensional shadow. It seemed very physical or quasi-physical. Uh-huh. And as I recall, I just like leapt out of bed, dashed past it, ran down the hall to this TV room that we had and hid underneath this yellow electrical heating blanket that we had at the time. And just like a child would, I hid under it. I peeked out to see if he was gone or if he had followed me. And as far as I could, and when I peeked out, he was still there. He had apparently followed me into this room and was still just standing at the entrance to this other room, staring at me. And that's where my memory ends. And, you know, following that, my parents, I told them about it. They convinced me it was a nightmare. I believed that for a very long time, but the memory always stuck in my mind. It's actually one of my earliest childhood memories.
And did you remember anything about what happened with him? What?
No, I don't know if anything happened. Generally, from my research, it seems like this figure is more of a watcher type for whatever reason. It rarely seems to interact with people. Even in my father's case and my uncle, they were sleeping on a bunk bed. This was back in the 60s again. And this entity walked, same exact entity, walked into their bedroom that they were sharing and just leaned over them. And that's it. And now some people would, you know, try to write this off as what people call sleep paralysis and kind of buzzwords like that. But that does nothing to explain shared encounters such as both my father and uncle had, nor the widespread phenomenon, which is this particular entity, in my opinion.
You know, I'm trying to, what happened to you later? You had other experiences, I believe.
Oh, yeah. So.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, we can get into that. So my interests, you know, continued, like I said, in the years following that, I learned to read. I became very obsessed with all sorts of these anomalous subjects. And then I think somewhere around my teenage years, I began to lose interest. I don't know exactly why. Maybe I just bought into some of the materialist, reductionist paradigm, which is so prevalent in our society. But for whatever case, I did lose interest a bit, but never entirely with whether it's UFOs or any paranormal subject. That is until my mid-20s. So this would be about 8 years ago. I began to experience all sorts of strange activity. Everything ranging from other type of shadowy entities at first, and then eventually alien visitations or abductions, out of body experiences, general sort of hauntings and telepathic downloads, all of that stuff. It all just kind of hit me like a wrecking ball at this particular time when I was around 25 or 26.
What was changing in your life at that time?
You know, I think what it really was my mental state. I was going through a bit of a traumatic time on multiple levels that I don't necessarily need to go into here, but suffice it to say that, well, I had just had a difficult breakup with my long-term partner at the time, and that combined with other things that were happening in my life did lead me into a deep depression. Fortunately, I recovered fairly quickly from it, and I'm all the better off for it, I think. I learned a lot, but it was during this time when I began to experience, these paranormal things again. And little bits and pieces of memory began to come back too from my childhood. But so it started with another shadow entity encounter. I'll just very quickly run through where this is the first one I remember. Again, I was about 25. I was staying at my mother's house at the time. She has since passed away in 2022. But I was staying at her place, and I was sleeping. And I woke up in the middle of the night one night, and I heard a voice at my bedroom door. And it was a male voice, and it said, "Can I come in?" And I was paralyzed with fear. And I don't recall even responding. I just know that this shadowy being walked into my room, got onto my bed, crawled towards me, and started trying to strangle me or smother me or something to that effect. And it was absolutely terrifying. At the time, I had still not really been... I had not gone through my flip, to quote Jeffrey Kripal. I had not yet fully embraced, the reality of these anomalous phenomena. So I did write it off as some strange nightmare or sleep paralysis or something like that. But I no longer feel that way. That was just my rationalization. So that progressed. I had a couple other incidents like that until... I learned to kind of fend them off, I guess you could say, these entities. I learned certain techniques to keep it from happening or to make them go away. A lot of the time it just came down to just saying like, "F off, go away, something to that effect. And it was shortly after that, maybe a year or so later, that I began to have these alien experiences.
Now, wait a minute. I'm trying to do this. I'm trying to use the solo layout so that you know people can really concentrate on what you're saying instead of watching me listen as mm-hmm. well. Now, but things must have been changing in some way. First, you've had a long period of time when you've been sort of unsure about it. You're listening to the world's denial. Mm-hmm. And then you get to the point where you're not listening to the denial anymore. And that's an interesting change, because you're, on the one hand, you're reading UFO stuff from an early age. On the other hand, you're kind of wanting to make the sleep paralysis thing happen to you. I mean, you wanting to be that. I remember when I was in the craft with the visitors being screwed with, I was trying to believe it was a nightmare, trying to make myself believe that. Now, when did you begin to stop wanting to make yourself believe that? I guess that's the way to phrase this question.
Yeah, no, that's a really good question. I hadn't quite thought about that, but I think the sleep paralysis experiences themselves kind of awakened me, in the sense that I gained a lot of sympathy for people like yourself and, you know, the many other experiencers out there who report things like alien visitations, because all of a sudden I was like, wow, this was absolutely real. You know, this felt realer than real in some ways. So there was that. I gained a bit of sympathy. I was also, I guess, reaching a stage in my life where I was a lot more interested in spiritual traditions and practices. I was getting into yoga for the first time, as well as meditation. And just that alone will do at least two things. It will open your mind and body to things that you might not have otherwise perceived. And then it will also, well, similarly, introduce you to a lot of concepts that you might not otherwise be aware of. So I was just gaining an overall more metaphysical conception of reality. I was becoming more open-minded and curious. And so it really all led up to that bombshell December 2017 article by Leslie Kane, Ralph Blumenthal, and Elaine Cooper, where after that dropped, and in the months leading up to it, I started paying attention to the subject again, the UFO subject specifically, and it almost felt like that article gave me permission to engage with these things mentally, with these subjects. So I don't know if that answers your question, but I think it was a combination of different things going on in my life.
Yeah, and also a different atmosphere, because when you saw the article, what did you think? You thought, my God, it's real. That's what you thought. Yeah.
Exactly.
And you're like, you know, the government is sort of backed into accepting that truth. I mean, they've admitted that some of these things are unknown. But there's a huge gap here. It's between us and the article. And we all thought to ourselves, anyone who had doubts about their experiences thought, my God, I have been in something at Israel. But the government thought, I think, only, okay, we've gone this far. How do we keep these unwanted people, the close encounter witnesses, out of this? How does that make you feel?
it's incredibly frustrating, you know, to this day, especially with everything going on with the most recent error report and so forth. At the time in 2017, it was incredibly exciting. It seems like maybe we were finally getting somewhere. And I do still think that we are getting somewhere.
Oh, hey, wait a minute. Folks, free Dreamlanders, here's the latest break. And remember, to do buy the books that we're selling and stuff, you know, you don't get a lot of ads on this station, on this podcast, just my stuff. And you don't get on Unknown Country either. So respect that, please, and subscribe to the show, because that's how we actually keep going. We'll be right back. Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get Them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me. We're talking to Close Encounter witness Paul Vidal. Paul has had numerous experiences in his life, and we're going to be getting to some of the physical effects in a short time. Let's go back to the way it makes you feel. The other thing is this: because of the government denial and the media's snickering or guffawing, depending on which media it is, or just ignoring us, which is a big part of it. Like, for example, I haven't had a review in the New York Times in more than 20 years. And maybe it's because they don't like my books, but I was regularly reviewed. And then after communion, I was regularly reviewed, and then suddenly it just stopped. And at that same time, there was a hardening against this whole thing. And I'm talking about back when you were a little bitty baby. So this goes back a while. That was the time when South Park did their first episode about and made my rape into an international joke. And it became the rectal probe instead of the rape of Whitley Strieber. And that really shut people down. It shut the public down. It shut the Close Encounter witnesses down. It silenced people, because people don't like to be laughed at. And somebody somewhere sensed that, and they decided to do whatever they could to hide this. So, and now here you are sitting here. And I just wonder what it was like to decide not to hide it.
Wow. Yeah. Whitley, I remember when that South Park episode came out. You know, I was probably a young teenager or something, and I probably laughed along with it. I don't know. I wasn't a huge South Park fan, frankly. I never have been. And I never, you know, considered the broader reality here. It's incredibly unfortunate how this stuff plays out. But I will say this, I've been laughed at. I've had people laugh in my face about this subject, particularly when I first started talking about it back in late 2017 and early 2018. I was attending college at the time. I went to college a few years after graduating high school, so graduated a little bit later in my mid to late 20s. And I remember being so excited about this subject and talking to my peers about it. And just literally being laughed at, having people question my sanity, like all, you know, all of that stuff. So God, I can only imagine. I can only imagine your position.
Did you receive any life harm because of it? In other words, you say laughed at. Did anything happen that harmed your life?
Not physically, but I have lost friends over this. I lost one of my best friends due to this subject. They, I guess, just didn't believe me or didn't want to believe me that I was actually having these experiences. I felt gaslit, and I think I was being gaslit. And, you know, I was still going through the process of coming to terms with the fact that I was an experiencer myself. And so, yeah, throughout the course of that, I lost one of my best friends. And it's been difficult.
You know, it's an interesting thing. I've talked to many, many experiencers in my life, and Anne had too. And we noticed something about them, many things that are unique to experiences. One, generally pretty mild-mannered people. And you think to yourself, well, you get a group of them together. We used to have Dreamland festivals, and most everybody in the festival was an experiencer. And Anne would say, they're so mild-mannered. And I said, of course they are. The visitors are a little invulnerable. They don't want to get people in there who are going to be raging and stuff. And she said, well, you did. I said, well, of course I did. But that for whatever reason, they had no choice but with me. They had to have me. And in any case, there is a kind of personality that's involved with this, but there's, in addition to the mild-manneredness, and you're expressing this too, there's an extreme sensitivity to separation. Like you're talking about how much it hurt, or you talked about a bad breakup earlier. You're talking about how much it hurt to lose this friend. These things hurt you more than they hurt most people. And me too. I'm broken up by the loss of a friend, or I recently lost a whole family. I was hopeful that they would be friends, and because I love to have friends, and I don't have many, and so I feel it too. Have you noticed that much among other close encounter witnesses? Because I'm acutely aware of this. It's like we're terribly sensitive to separation.
Yes. Yeah. Definitely. I've noticed an overall sensitivity among experiencers. I almost feel like I have a psychic connection to other experiencers sometimes, but that's a bit of a different story. Yeah. But as far as that goes, yes, especially, well, I think it's true for experiencers in general. I find the ones that are still sort of in the closet, so to speak, about it, that they're almost the most bashful in some ways, because, you know, that they're maybe still going through a process themselves of coming to terms with what may or may not have happened to them. And then the ones that speak out, like I have and like you have, I think that it hits us very hard, and I know it has me, this type of separation. I don't know what that is. I don't know if it's maybe from a lifetime of feeling, again, sort of gaslit. I know that term gets a little overused, but...
What do you mean by, when you say gaslit, what do you mean?
Just made to feel that you can't trust your own sanity or that you can't trust your own perception. You can't trust yourself in a way that people tell you, oh, you know, whether you're 5, 6 years old like I was, and, you know, I don't blame my parents whatsoever, but saying like, you know, it was just a nightmare, or whether it's, you know, my peers, you know, literally laughing at me, or whether it's the doubting that we do to ourselves, or at least that I did to myself when I was first coming to terms with this. And I know from reading Communion that it seems like you went through at least a similar process back in the 80s.
So absolutely. Well, I still do.
Yeah.
I was in Texas a week ago and with my family and friends, and people were laughing up their sleeves at me the same way they always do. Snickering and snickering. And I've had to endure that now for most of my adult life, and including from some of my closest friends. And, you know, if you want your friends, you have to accept that from them. And I just keep thinking to myself, if things were different, if this was more open and more accepted, think what kind of therapies and treatments we could have access to. Therapies that haven't even been invented yet. We represent a revolution that is being buried alive, basically. That's what we are.
I could not agree more.
Yeah. We need to get into the... wait a minute. Let's do another break here. Okay, for the free side of Dreamland, we're taking a break. We'll be right back.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
Okay, we're back. We're talking to Paul Vidal, a close encounter witness, and we're kvetching basically about what it's like to be a close encounter witness. And it's time to get down to the nitty-gritty, Paul.
Let's do it.
Start talking about just what happened to you that is the big things that brought you into this, because the shadow man didn't do that. Something else did.
Yes. So like I said, things began to escalate in my mid-20s. Various shadow figures went away. I really have not experienced that since. So it's been several years. And it would so that began back in 2016, and around 2018 I had a very profound experience very quickly, where I once again woke up in the middle of the night, and my whole house was lit up somehow with this kind of amber light, and I was not paralyzed or anything. I was wide awake, not dreaming. And I sensed a presence in my house. And I was once again actually staying in this home, my deceased mother's home. And I felt this presence walking toward my bedroom. I don't know how I sensed it, I just did. There was also this profound, eerie sense of familiarity, like this had happened before. And just this knowledge that they were coming for me, whoever this was. And as I felt this presence reach my bedroom door, all of a sudden, all at once, I both heard and felt this unbelievably profound vibration start to spread throughout my body. It seemed to come from the window behind me again, which faced outside. I was sitting in an armchair at the time, which was also odd. I thought maybe I dozed off in this armchair. It was very strange, but this force that seemed to be coming from outside, just behind me, it was this sort of a vibrational sensation that was both a sound and a feeling, and it was kind of like a generator kicking on, kind of like a womp womp womp. Womp, 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 womp. And it got louder and louder and stronger and stronger. It started in like my solar plexus and then spread throughout my entire body. And I tried to fight it because it was utterly terrifying and I had no idea what was going on. I thought maybe I was dying or the thought crossed through my head that I might be getting abducted by aliens. For the first time, this thought came to me. This was February of 2018, so it was a few months after the New York Times article. And so as this was happening, over the course of about 30 seconds to a minute, this vibration noise spread throughout my extremities. I tried to fight it, but eventually became paralyzed by it. And then this black static filled my vision, and I lost consciousness. I then woke up about 4 to 5 hours later, no longer in this armchair that I was in, but now I was laying in my bed across the room, and I was wearing a flannel similar to this one, and it was strangely unbuttoned, where like the middle buttons were unbuttoned, exposing my chest, and I was laying like this, like a mummy, and I felt like I was coming out of anesthesia. My arms were laid on my exposed chest. My sheet was like gently folded off of me, and I just slowly came back to consciousness and was like, what just happened? What was that? And I was utterly baffled. I got out of bed. Like I said, I was staying at my mother's at the time. Eventually I went and told her about it. That led to a whole other series of stories where she revealed to me that she had experiences like this, and that was that. So at this time I did not see any entities, but that quickly changed. So to get to the point that I think we're driving at here, where did the flip occur to me? Again, to borrow the term from Jeffrey Kripal, where did I start to awaken to the reality of this stuff? Well, that started it, that launched me into this scene. I could not stop reading about abductions, visitations, UFOs, all sorts of paranormal stuff, you name it. And about, so over the course of the next 2 to 3 years, from 2018 to 2021, I had several experiences that I don't think we have time to go into here, but they were very alien-like in nature. I had one experience where an entity spoke to me telepathically and stuck something down my throat into my stomach. I had sort of little sightings of what appeared to be gray beings. And then eventually in 2021, once again, February of 2021, this was the big one. I woke up one night and I saw the silhouette of a small being standing near my bedside. It looked exactly like your typical gray, although I could not see its features this time. It had the bulbous head, 3.5-4 feet tall, and it was just standing there. And at the same time, there were these vibrations. It seemed like the atmosphere of my room was charged with some sort of vibration as I laid there staring at it. So 2 days after that, I woke up from a completely dreamless sleep, which is very unusual for me. I dream virtually every single night. I'm a very active and lucid dreamer, and I keep a dream journal. But I woke up from this dreamless sleep, and I felt this pain on my left leg, the back of my left leg. It was inside of my calf muscle. and it was not on the surface or anything. It was inside of the muscle. So my first thought was, oh, I must have pulled the muscle in my leg in my sleep, like I'd gotten a Charlie horse or something from stretching too hard. But that doesn't make sense to me, because that's happened to me a few times in the past. And I will always wake up when that happens, because it's so painful if you've ever pulled a muscle in your sleep like that. So
we're going to take another brief break for our free Dreamlanders. And when we get back, we're going to go into these injuries, and we're going to show at that time a picture of, we'll bring up a photo of Paul's scratches and one of mine, and side by side. Should be interesting, so stay with us.
Did we misunderstand the teaching of Jesus? Perhaps a long time ago, perhaps almost as soon as he rose from the dead, we mistook him for something that he may not have been. But we do know one thing: he was one of us. His life and his resurrection reveal the power of the good in all of us. And his teaching shows anybody, whether they have religious beliefs or not, how to find that goodness and live it. Get Jesus a New Vision. It's available as an audio book. It is available as a paperback and as a Kindle. Get it today. UnknownCountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe, in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations. But more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind, as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future.
We're talking to Paul Vidal. He is a close encounter witness and experiencer in the middle of telling us an extraordinary story. So let's just keep on, Paul. Go right ahead.
Okay. So I wake up 2 days after seeing this small gray alien figure beside my bed. That just a silhouette that time. 2 days later, I wake up with this pain inside of my muscle. Initially, when I first woke up, I did write it off for at least the first few minutes of waking. I just thought, oh, it was a Charlie horse or something. I didn't look at it or anything at the time. It's probably, I don't know, 20, 30 minutes later, I was getting dressed, you know, getting ready for the day. And as I'm putting some pants on, I happened to glance at the back of my left leg and saw these, what appeared to be eight little dots, eight little scabs in a nearly perfect line, very neatly staggered on the back of my leg. And I was completely taken aback. I was dumbfounded, especially because prior to this, I had been suspecting that I might actually be a real experiencer. I hadn't quite come to terms with it, but I was looking for a sign. And I almost wonder if maybe the visitors answered that request by providing a physical sign in this manner.
Well, I have a place on my leg, on my right leg, which they attend to quite frequently. It's a little, you will be seeing it now on the screen, those of you who are watching the video. And for those of you who aren't, it's a neat round spot on my just on the side of my inner calf muscle. And it has been there for about 10, 15 years, I guess. And every once in a while, there will be a needle, tiny, extremely thin needle put into the center of it that I barely feel, and sometimes I sleep through, I'm sure. What it does exactly, I don't know. But one night, I woke up and was aware of the fact that there was something in the bed with me between my legs. And since I have no animals in the house, I naturally quickly concluded that whatever it was, it shouldn't be there. And I leaped out of the bed, leaving the two scratches you see now, and we're putting them up beside Paul's scratch, and it's similar, but his looked more like punctures. And was that how they were punctured? What happened in my case is I jumped out of the bed, the being leapt out of the bed, I probably a gray, at the same time, because naturally it had been in there, and it wasn't going to stay in there a long time, and shot into the bathroom like a rocket, and was mm-hmm. gone instantly. And the scratches were from these at least have long fingernails, claws almost, and the scratches were from those. So go ahead and tell, let's continue now with your story, and we'll pull the pictures off and what you saw, what those of you listening only didn't see were the pictures of Paul's marks and my marks side by side.
Great. Yeah. So I do think that they were puncture wounds. That's why I mentioned the sensation inside of my muscle. Frankly, what it felt like was what you'd call an intramuscular injection, just like you would get if you were having a vaccine or various other treatments from a doctor. Not subcutaneous, but deep, deep, deep into the muscle. And it was not a throbbing or radiating pain. It was the type of pain where every time I would flex the muscle, I would feel it. If I was just stationary, I wouldn't feel anything at all. And there was absolutely no topical sensation. In other words, nothing on the skin, no feeling on my skin, no itching, no pain or anything like that. And I also think that they were puncture wounds or something to that effect because of the spacing of them, the clear lack of a laceration or abrasion in between them, and just the evenness, as well as the way that they looked in the subsequent months. Like Whitley, you mentioned that this round spot that you have is still there 15 years later or something. I actually still have scars. They're incredibly faintly visible, but I still have scars a full 3+ years later. I don't know if they're going to stay there forever, but that's a long time for anything natural. And I should also mention that there was 3.5 feet of snow outside at the time here in North Jersey. You can confirm this, you know, if you look up the weather back in February of 2021. And this place was immaculate. So there was no chance that that it was a bug bite or anything like that. I've also shown it to medical professionals, and they all agree that it looks very strange. And I've been given the opinion that they almost look like a biopsy, like a deep sort of biopsy of some type.
A biopsy. How interesting. Free side of Dreamland. Goodbye. Goodbye. I'll see you again next week. I love you very much. And subscribers, we're going to keep right on keeping on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.